So we're going to change our focus again. Before we do, you have actually been sitting still for more than 90 minutes. Did you know that the blood flow through the back of your leg dropped by 50% sitting still for 90 minutes? So you're all getting up and you're going to just kick your legs around for 2 minutes. We cannot be responsible for your seated immobility thrombosis. So thank you very much. That's great. So I can be assured you're not all going to get DVT. Do sit down again. Thank you. So we now change our focus to the psychological effects of venous thromboembolism. This is a totally new area. We have heard some from the patients how much suffering they have had. And Dr. Simon Noble, who is our Welsh medical director, has made this field his own and has actually produced just the first academic reviews of the psychological effects of venous thromboembolism. So, Simon, please come and tell us all about it.
Thank you very much, Beverly, for the invitation. And, you know, normally when I give talks, I have lots of comedy slides, but I really don't find anything funny about what I'm going to talk about. So, what I can promise, though, maybe I might be slightly entertaining when I have a bit of a rant later on, as what I see is a bit of an inequity of our focus when we look at what's important to patients. So whenever we talk about the cost of thrombosis, we often talk in money, we often talk in health resource usage, and often the reasons we do that is because, as you can see, that Lifeblood, amongst other stakeholders, has worked tirelessly to promote the importance of prevention of VTE and appropriate treatment of VTE. And you have to talk the same language as the people who are going to direct health policy. And one of the problems is that if we look at the cost of thrombosis that way, and then for those of you who are patients or carers or health professionals involved in thrombosis, you know, you may see other aspects to what is important, but it's much harder to quantify. So we talk about the number of deaths due to thrombosis or number of avoidable deaths. And actually, we've heard that many times. And these are tragedies. And every single one of those has a story. There are people here who've lost loved ones to thrombosis. But you know what? When we start presenting numbers to people, you know, one death is a tragedy. Thousands of deaths becomes a statistic, and people stop seeing the individual tragedy of, you know, every death. And we've heard a lot today about the cost of how much it costs to treat deep vein thrombosis, the symptomatic costs. We even know that you get a reduced quality of life. But it's interesting, when we say reduced quality of life, what do we mean by that? What you may think of as quality of life and how you assess it, when we're looking in academic papers, we're talking about validated tools which give you points according to pain in the leg, what you're able to do in the day, how you felt, you know, whether you've been able to work, etc. And it gives you a number. So it gives you the kind of the numbers, but it doesn't tell you what it means to the people. And actually, how many points difference on a quality of life tool is it when someone's life has been made not worth living, or it's the clot has been inconsequential to them? You know, what do these numbers mean? But they are helpful in academic papers in showing, oh, look, we improve quality of life as well. See, we do care about patients. We know about post-thrombotic syndrome. We've learned, we've had some fantastic talks today and fantastic talks this afternoon about post-thrombotic syndrome. And, you know, to have it so eloquently described the impact on someone's life that post-thrombotic syndrome has had really brings it home. And I wish that every clinician involved in healthcare could hear that, could actually see what goes on beyond that 20-minute clinic appointment or that 5-minute ward round, what actually happens to the patients when they go home and live with thrombosis. We only get a snapshot of what our patients go through. There's another aspect as well when you look at the societal impact. I see a lot of patients who've come through their cancer journey. I see 260 new cases of cancer-associated thrombosis. Many are in patients who are having curative treatment. So the cancer is beyond them, but they're still living with the consequences of cancer-associated thrombosis. And I'll tell you something interesting. This is not only what the patients have brought to me, but also what we've seen in academic studies. Patients who've experienced cancer-associated thrombosis, symptomatic thrombosis, describe that their experience of CAT, cancer-associated thrombosis, was more distressing than their experience of cancer. Now, is that a surprise? Well, many people with a diagnosis of cancer that is picked up on screening, or the symptoms that have declared the cancer may not have been particularly distressing. They also are spoken to and given the diagnosis by people who've been specifically told, when you break the news about cancer, you are breaking bad news. You need to be trained. You need to have a certain style of doing it. Cancer patients, when they get their diagnosis of cancer-associated thrombosis, it's often rushed. The symptoms are often quite frightening. The symptoms have often been there for a while, and no one has warned them that they may get clots. So they delay presenting because, well, I've got cancer, I'm bound to feel crap. And then it's a bit of a rush, they're not getting information, and when they get the diagnosis, it's just, oh yeah, you've got clots, here's your medicine, you can go home. So what do we do when we don't get enough information? We go online. We go onto that anarchic library, which has got some many very useful pages, but it's also got pages that will terrify us. And we get given information, we get that news broken to us that we've got this potentially fatal condition without the associated support. So when I think about breaking bad news, and when I'm thinking about it in the context of cancer, I talk about breaking further bad news. And that information needs to be conveyed with the same empathy and time and information and support as the original cancer diagnosis. But cancer-associated thrombosis is just a small part of thrombosis. So let's talk about some of the work we've done. Interestingly, whenever we look at these things, I've used these slides for years now, and I realise that each one of these patients has their own story. The person who's got the saddle embolus, that patient used to like hill mountain biking. Massive mad mountain biker. The legs there, they belong to a guy who's got three grandchildren who he's very proud of, and they call him Bampy. Still remember that, but it's just a picture at the moment, isn't it? We don't see the person behind it. And so with some colleagues of mine from Swansea University, the Department of Psychology, we wanted just to get a feel for, are there any psychological long-term effects from people who've experienced VTE? And so what we did was we focused on those we thought were most likely to have them, and that was those who had had large symptomatic pulmonary emboli. And I'm not going to go into the methodology too much. This paper, we paid for it to be open access, so you can find it online, you can read it. We've written it in as non-upper own bottoms academic way so that other people can understand it rather than just the kind of academics. And what we did was we interviewed patients who had experienced a symptomatic pulmonary embolism that was symptomatic enough for them to warrant admission. We interviewed these people, we transcribed the interviews, and then we analysed them. I won't go through any of that, you can read it in the paper. But these were the major themes, because when you do these interviews, you try and say, are there these common things that appear that each patient is raising in a similar way? And here, there are three major themes, each with sub-themes. Number one, and we've heard it, how many of our, I think all our people who've experienced VTEs have spoken today, have said that their lives have been changed. They can tell you the date, a life-changing event, the experience of shock. I'll come through some of this later. Loss of self, that they're not the same person. Some people have actually taken that as an opportunity to reevaluate their lives, maybe reprioritize things, or change the direction in which they are going in their life. And interestingly also, some people talk about avoidance behaviours. Now, the bit that's interested and surprised, well, didn't surprise us, was that amongst this population, and it was a very selected population, there was actually a high prevalence of post-traumatic stress disorder. And I'll explain that a little bit more, because PTSD is not just something that you see in people in the trenches. And the other thing that came very clear was the support needs of people with VTE. We've heard about how the lifeblood buddy system, how well that works, because that is meeting a need, the opportunity to talk with people who've been through what you've been through, who understand and can assure you that the thoughts you're having, the fears you're having are the same, are similar. Sometimes people just want to know that I'm not, you know, what I'm going through is normal for this experience. So I'm going to use basically the patient voice. That's what we've tried to do with this study. These are direct quotes from the interviews. So people talking about a shock. Why has it happened to me? I've heard that said today. Why me? It was awful not knowing what caused it. It's that uncertainty. When we can explain things, it's a very blokey thing as well. When we can explain things, we can cope with it more. But if we don't understand it, if we live with uncertainty, that's a struggle. Here, so having to live with that uncertainty has caused me to worry a lot, because no one can say for definite that A, it'll never happen again, and B, if it did, would never get to the next level, where next time I wouldn't be so lucky. So these people are living with uncertainty, and the uncertainty of whether a potentially life-threatening condition may happen again. Loss of self. Edmund Hillary said that a mind truly changed by experience will never go back to its old dimensions. Once you've had a life-changing experience, by definition, your life is different. We strive to get back to normality, but what we go through if we have a thrombotic event changes us physically, changes us emotionally, will change us because of the medicines that we're on, many of us for the rest of our lives. Now, what are the things that lead someone to get post-traumatic stress disorder? And I will not say I am not an expert on this. My colleagues in Swansea, in particular Paul Bennett, has done a lot of work looking at the incidence of PTSD in people who've had heart attacks, people who've had genetic counselling for cancer. But there are certain features that make it more likely to happen. People who have had previously good health or living in what they consider normality will experience an unanticipated, traumatic, life-threatening event. And then they will live with an uncertainty about the future regarding recurrence. So we're ticking all the boxes there for people who've had a thrombosis. So what are the sort of symptoms that people with PTSD get? The major ones are things like flashbacks. So memories of the event, getting those flashbacks, there may be triggers for that. Perhaps the person, when they're giving their injections or taking their tablets, that is a daily reminder of this condition, this traumatic event. They will have hypervigilance. You're no longer allowed to have an achy leg because you've been for a run. That achy leg is another clot until proven otherwise. You're not allowed to have everyday symptoms. We see this with cancer patients. If you've had cancer, you can't stub your toe anymore. You've got cancer in the toe. You feel breathless, you have a twinge in your chest, and you've had thrombosis, you've got a recurrent VTE. You are hypervigilant of symptoms, and every single one has the potential to cause distress. Some people have avoidance behaviours, will avoid doing things that may increase the risk. Some people have a sort of feeling of numbness, that it's none of it feels real. So what did our patients say? Can I get to this? I think that's all I've covered on that. The final thing there is the support needs. We have a group of patients who are not getting the information that they require at the right time. They need to be given this information so they understand what's happened, what is going to be done for them, and what the future holds. When they can make sense of that, the future is more manageable. So these people do need information, or else they will get it from somewhere else. Here's a patient. This is very common. It was just a case of you've had these clots, they've gone to your lungs, none of the rest of what else could have happened before they got to the lungs registered, or see how serious it was when it got there. They were numbed, they didn't hear any of it. You know, at the front line, it's the junior doctors that are going to be seeing these people often. You know, sometimes it is the least experienced people giving this information. You know, DVT, PE, oh, that's a piece of cake, isn't it? You just anticoagulate them, we've got a pathway for that. But what about the information needs? What about the support needs? Need for empathy. I'll be honest with you, this is me laying bare my soul for what a heartless junior doctor I was. There was this lady who was one of the volunteer drivers. And one day she came in with a DVT and we treated it. And whenever I saw her later, she'd go, Hayden, still fighting, still surviving. And I was going, you're nuts, it was just a DVT. How little did I know? You know, I've learned a lot in 20 years. You know, I didn't appreciate what was going through her mind. I just saw this weeny little pathology that I treated her with this tablet. She went home. I never saw her again. She was anticoagulated for 6 months by a GP. Why the hell are you perpetuating this DVT survivor thing? That was my ignorance. This lady, I might have died. That my daughter might not have had her mum. No one helping to make sure that I understood what was going on or what was wrong with me or how this would affect my life. I just remember feeling quite resentful of the medical staff. Now that sort of comment, with the best will in the world, will get doctors and nurses going, ooh, aren't you getting all hoity-toity? Oh, you know, here we have, we've saved your life, we've given you life-saving drugs, and now you're getting arsy, we didn't do that. They ain't seeing you for the rest of your life living with that traumatic episode. Patient information, patient support is vital. One patient said, I'd love and still would like to have some sort of group thing or support to be available to come help me come to terms with what's happened to me. Somewhere where someone could have explained, yeah, it's normal to feel like that, etc. Just understanding that the experiences you're having are normal, are par for the course. Maybe other people who've been through the same thing. So clearly what's happening here is where we in the NHS have not met this need. You're meeting the need yourselves, no doubt better. I don't think I'd have felt so on my own then. Just have had this level of conversation with somebody back then would have helped massively to help me through the process. Through it all, though, because it was very off you go and that was that. And I think this is the thing. People get very blasé about it. People assume, junior doctors assume, you don't get recurrent VTEs. Oh, patients being readmitted with a DVT, they're on warfarin. Well, I don't think there's a DVT, really. You know, I've seen this happen. And something else that's just been published in the Journal of Health Psychology by Paul Bennett, my colleague, myself, is actually a study which Lifeblood has to take an immense amount of credit for, because through Lifeblood and through social media, these questionnaires were put out there to people. I'm sure there are people in the audience who actually participated in this, and thank you, because you've allowed us to further our knowledge about this condition. And what this questionnaire did, and I won't go too much into it, it's got loads of graphs even I don't understand half the time, but we asked patients who'd had VTE to do a scoring which showed about levels of anxiety and distress, and also look at post-traumatic stress disorder indicators. And what it basically identified, that there was a correlation between the amount of anxiety you expressed at the time of the VTE and the propensity to go on and develop symptoms of PTSD. Now, the reason that's useful is it means we can actually target and highlight those people who are most likely to have ongoing psychological problems. And if we can target them at the right time, we can target psychological support therapies. And there are psychological interventions which can minimize long-term problems. In the same way that we hear, you know, kind of early recanalization of veins will decrease your risk of post-thrombotic syndrome, early intervention to prevent long-term psychological complications can be done. So in our audience, we have Rachel. Where are you, Rachel? Rachel's currently doing a PhD with us at the University of Swansea and is looking at bringing in a psychological intervention at the early on in the diagnosis to try and prevent long-term complications. So I think we know that VTE confers a significant psychological burden, not just in people who had massive symptoms, but people who've had mild symptoms. We're seeing as well that the psychological impact of uncertainty of what could have happened, that takes its toll. We hear about many things, practices that are damaging, the blasé attitude to the VTE, the rushed attitude. Those things aren't rocket science. You do not need 5 years at medical school to teach you how to just take a little bit more time or recognize the importance of this diagnosis. It's possible we'll be able to target those at risk of greatest distress. But I think most importantly, we need to actually be able to recognize and get those people in the important places to recognize the emotional consequences. My little rant, and maybe this is just me being all kind of, no one appreciates how wonderful my research is, but you tell me one thrombosis journal that is interested in qualitative research. If it ain't got a p-value, they're not interested. You know, this World Thrombosis Day is about patients. So what I would challenge the steering committee is that your journal, which is part of this, actually by next year, for next World Thrombosis Day, has published some qualitative research or research which directly identifies the patient experience. Don't have to be my research, but it'd be nice. But what I'm saying is this sort of research at the moment is getting published in the Journal of Health Psychology. Who here, apart from Rachel, reads the Journal of Health Psychology? That is not where the papers need to be. It needs to be with the professionals who are seeing patients, general physicians, hematologists, specialist nurses. That's where it needs to be. And actually, if we start having the journals saying we recognise this as important and we are going to be very strict to the criteria because the first paper we publish better be shit hot, that's fine. But do not send back rejection letters to say, we don't deal with qualitative research before you even review. We don't do that. We don't do that. We're doing brilliantly on what's happening on a molecular level. We're doing brilliantly at bringing new drugs to the field. But at the moment, we are crap at the bit that goes on inside here. So that's my call to arms. And back at you, more controversial than you, mate. Thank you.
Missed out GPs there, Simon.
That's because I knew you were going to mention it.
Because we do quite a lot of qualitative research also. I mean, absolutely agree with you. Any questions for Simon? No, you've been absolutely clear. I think your call to arms is well made, and let's not just get it into the Society of Hematology. It should be in the BMJ, shouldn't it?
They no longer take qualitative research. That is what I was just told when I submitted something there.
There is somewhere where the patients can go, and that is to Lifeblood. And really, we would encourage physicians and patients to come to us. We do have our buddy system where you can be paired up with someone else with similar problems. We have a Facebook page. If you think that we can help us, please just get in contact through our telephone or through our website.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Simon.